the masterpiece I painted. A portrait of one of my favorite actors. Any guesses? This is Johnny Depp for you. I guess now is a good time to tell you that I'm not an artist. I'm sure you figured that out already by now. Unless you agree with me that there's an artist in each one of us. Growing up in a heritage city like Mysore, art was the magnificent Mysore Palace. The beautiful rangolis that adorn the houses in the neighborhood. The art of yoga that brings people from all around the world to Mysore. At home, it was the books and the articles that my mom authored. The music that my dad would play on his mandolin. And the food that he cooked with so much passion on his days off. While I had a lot of appreciation towards art, I was generally better at math than at acting, drawing, or music. While staying at the top in academics was relatively easier, I barely managed to get through the auditions for the school play. I got the smallest role there was, only because my best friend directed it. Nevertheless, my appreciation and admiration towards art only grew bigger with age. I realized how powerful art is. I could look at a painting and find a sense of calm and comfort. I hear a song, my mood is transformed. I read a book, I watch a play or a movie. It stays with me for days and makes me look at the same things differently. While I was in the US, I stumbled upon a pottery studio. And I happened to try my hand at the pottery wheel. I instantly fell in love with it and I found a new zen. Living abroad can profoundly change who you are. My stay outside India gave me an opportunity to look at arts expansively. It gave me an insight into India's rich and ancient art heritage from a global perspective. I started learning and researching more and more. I developed a new sense of pride. Every region in India has its own style and unique pattern of art. I learned that there's a vibrant style of painting called Madhubani that dates back to the Ramayana era. A simple folk art called Varli that tells me every time simple living is the best. I learned that Mysore style of painting came into life when our kind-hearted warriors patronized the art form. They gave shelter to the fleeting artisans from Hampi after the gruesome battle of Talikota. These stories inspired me to meet some of the ancestral artists. Unfortunately, there are only a handful of them left today. I met a veteran potter, Mr. Basil Rajappa, who has won several awards. He's recreated the pottery from Harappan era. Despite his age, he was more than happy to come and teach. I met a tribal Varli artist from Maharashtra who happened to be in Mysore, and she graciously offered to paint the walls of my studio. I met Kishore Chitragar, one of the master artisans. One of the only remaining 13 families that practice the Kinala art on wood. I wanted to create a platform. And right there, I wanted to create a platform where I could not only collectively work towards renewing and recreating awareness towards these dwindling art forms, but also by making it an easier, accessible, and an enjoyable experience for anybody to learn these art forms. This love of mine for arts and entrepreneurship made me take the leap of faith. And today, I run a creative space where I collaborate with some of the incredible artists across the world. It's been 5 years and I've met some wonderful people, made some amazing friends, have interesting conversations, and helping them explore their creativity and fostering artists and spreading art more than anything every single day. And I'm happy to say that I found my calling. It's been 5 magical years in this world of art. And today here, I would like to share with you my 3 key learnings, along with a few inspiring stories, transformative stories, and testimonies. My first learning is that art helps young and old deal with the stresses of life. Every day, I interact with people from diverse backgrounds, from a new mom to an empty nester, from a working professional to a homemaker, from someone who has retired recently to a student. I see a pattern in which each one of them seek hope, optimism, and confidence through the medium of art. Art gives them small wins to cope with a stressful situation. Art gives them baby steps to get through whatever they are going through. One such artistic journey is lived by Deekshita, a brilliant 11th grader. Like any other student in India, her day revolves around school, academics, and assignments. Yet, I see Deekshita making time for her painting session. When I asked her what motivated her, this is what she had to say. Art is metanoia to me. When I'm worked up and have a million things going on in my head, all I need is some time to paint and I can think better. The bright hues on my palette unleash a spark in me that's forced to conform otherwise. Colors are my day-long obsession, joy and torment. Art sets me free from all of the world's heaviness and gloom. The quirky toying about that is I lose myself in it and I find myself there at the same time. Another inspiring lady, Mrs. Jyoti, a 50-year-old career woman who always makes time for her art session, even if it's for as less as 30 minutes. When I asked her what does that motivates her to be, you know, back after work, in spite of having a tight, you know, work schedule. For her, art is her anxiety-relieving therapy. It's her escape route from the mental and physical pressures of life. My second learning is that art, as a social experience, is more powerful than solitary art. With changing phases of life, we often feel lonely, even if people surround us at some point or the other. With nuclear families on the rise, the aging population is hit the most. With a decline in social outings and contacts, they experience a higher level of isolation. I heard a brilliant TED talk by a psychiatrist, Robert Waldinger. He is one of the 6 directors of the Harvard study of adult development, perhaps one of the longest studies done in the history. It's a 75-year-old study. And the outcome of that study, according to him, he says social connections are the single most important thing that determines how fulfilling, healthy, and long your life is. People who are socially connected tend to live happier, longer, and healthier. It's not your cholesterol level. It's not your fitness. Don't start eating now. But it's none of that. It's your closest relationships. It's your social connections that make sure you live a happy and a long life. This talk inspired me to see and explore how I could make art as a social experience. I started enabling parents, grandparents, siblings, and family and friends to just get together, spend some quality time together, laugh, learn, create. Because years from now, it won't matter what they created, just that they did it together. Family dynamics can be challenging. I'm sure all of you will agree with me. But when you take time and spend some creative time, share creative experience together, it can be extremely rewarding. Your appreciation towards each other increases that much more. You work towards deeper bonds. One such, and also like, you know, just like how when you work out in a group, you're more motivated, right? You're more motivated and you're focused and you're inspired more. Similarly, when you decide to create art together, even if it's in the company of absolute strangers, there's a high chance that you make lasting social connections. And if you decide to do that in the company of your own family and friends, you're just making your relationships that much more fulfilling. In this context, I would like to share a story of one Mr. Rajan, a 65-year-old retired bank officer who never had the time, nor the inclination or opportunity to pursue art of any form. But then after his retirement, he took the courage to get out of his comfort zone and he started learning one art form after the other. Not only did he develop a new social circle for himself, he became an inspirational figure among his family and friends. Just for the fact that he was spending his time so constructively after retirement and taking care of his own emotional well-being, he became an inspirational figure. My third learning is that there's an artist in each one of us. Everybody is an artist. My 4-year-old daughter is creative and spontaneous. She inspires me to dance, sing, and be happy for no reason. She's full of ideas and imagination. She can cook up a story about anything almost instantly. The amount of storytelling and drama children do, I wonder whoever said kids don't lie. Like any other child her age, she naturally loves art. Children love art naturally. They love painting, they love music, they love to dance for no reason. But the sad reality is, as we grow up, we let that child, I'm sure all of us were like that at some point or the other, right? But as we grow, we let that inner child, that inner artist die. We often find hundreds of reasons not to do art. We're either too busy, too old, or it's not our thing. For the longest time, I thought I was not the artsy kind. I was into math and sports and anything else, but not arts. Even if we do, we start analyzing and judging our art as good or bad. We start worrying what people are going to say. Like you saw my Johnny Depp. The point here is not all art that you create needs to be in a gallery or on stage or in a book. You can use art as a means of self-expression, relaxation, and for your own emotional well-being. So splash some colors on a canvas or just take a music lesson with a stranger. Or sign up for an offbeat art class. Because not only is it liberating, it also increases your self-awareness, your emotional intelligence, and it makes you live a happier, healthier, and a more fulfilling life. There has been a lot of research today that says art can be medicine for food and, art can be medicine for your body and soul. It's been proven that art, when you create art, you can keep dementia, Alzheimer's, and depression at bay. So remember to nurture that inner artist in you. Keep exploring your creativity and get in touch with that inner artist in you. Thank you.